It's my huge delight to welcome Darla Crispin here as the keynote for this Artistic Research Symposium. I think for many of us, she's been one of those pioneers that has opened our eyes to possibilities in the field of artistic research. Back in 2009, when the Artistic Turn, a manifesto, came out, that sort of solidified thinking and galvanised that idea of possibility. We'd all been sort of working, but working in the dark and weren't quite sure how to step forward. And of course, that publication is with Kathleen Kersens and Douglas. And it was also multidisciplinary. The idea of it being like visual arts and philosophy and music as a starting point of our field is really, really interesting. And I've got no idea if that's going to come up today. I like that. Darla comes from Canada, where she did her undergraduate, moved to Guildhall, where she did further studies, and then ended up at the Orpheus Institute for 5 or 6 or 7 or some years in Ghent, which really became a central point in Europe of artistic research for a period of time, not in small part due to Darla's presence there at the Orpheus Institute. And now she's moved on to northern parts of the world. Just trying to work out your trajectory, your topographical trajectory in life.
Moving towards the Arctic Circle. Yeah.
So it makes sense that she flew down that way to come and visit us here in Australia. It's an absolute delight to have her here. She'll be presenting for about 50 minutes or so, and then we'll have time for questions at the end. Please make welcome Darla Crispin.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Right. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here today. I'm very grateful to see you all. I want to start by saying, first of all, how grateful I am to colleagues at Queensland College of Art, so Griffith University, the School of Music at the University of Queensland. Thank you for the invitation. I'm really thankful to Liam, Vanessa, and Charu for kind of spearheading this, making this happen. Thanks for the planning of the event. And I've already written 5 pages of notes, so you must have done something right. Now, we've been hearing a lot already this morning about how artistic research is being developed and valorized by the lead institutions in this symposium. I'd now like to offer some approaches that can be taken up within any kind of institution working within the artistic research field. This potential transferability is really important for our work, and it's well worth traveling the planet to share it, I think. So let's take stock of aspects of where artistic research stands in relation to really the momentous world events of recent years, and propose some models for how it might help to explain not just our art, but ourselves. I'd like to keep transferability and impact in the foreground of our thinking. In this process, I hope to bring forward notions that may foreshadow some of the next moves internationally and touch upon elements of ethics in artistic research. I feel that much of this kind of work fits the Australian context particularly well, and that as the field becomes ever more globalized, the role of Australian institutions could be even more influential. So in a sense, this presentation is intended to act as a hinge. It's a site of folding. And this image is not accidental, since following Gilles Deleuze and Julian Rose and others, it's this idea of the fold that I want to talk about as an organizational metaphor for all of us. In this metaphor, art making itself acts as a site of folding and unfolding, a site of pressure, rupture, fracture, transformation, and the potential point of the emergence of new shapes, new functions, new ideas, and even and especially new knowledge. In current geopolitical terms, ideas of the fold as eliciting a change of direction and even a rupture, well, they seem very opposite, don't they? Until just a few years ago, we could scarcely have imagined the kinds of events that would come to shape the global discourse as it moves into 2019 and beyond. Looking out into our world, the theme of the last year seems to be less of a matter of unfolding and more of unraveling. The administration of a dysfunctional US president the implementation of a wafer-thin Brexit, the re-emergence of unhealthy kinds of nationalism, alongside coping with a more treacherous world as climate change takes its toll, and you've got fires in Queensland now. A host of things that seem inconceivable or comfortably distant have come to pass, and the majority of the predictions of our experts have been proven wrong. And we're an expert class. We need to look at ourselves in all of this. This failure of intellectual elites in the political and economic sphere has further undermined the idea of the respect for expertise in general amongst global citizenry. So, what does it mean in such times to be engaged in the world of arts and ideas and to be fired by an appetite for their explication, literally their unfolding? What is expertise now? And amongst the fields of expertise, what kind of value can we claim as artists, researchers, or people devoted to the arts? What can we claim for that which concerns itself with artistic understanding? For those of us who live or have lived there, the consequences of the Brexit vote in the United Kingdom have forced many to fear the survival of idealism, especially the idealistic aspects of international cooperation. That includes cooperation not just in the EU countries, but within countries in the European Economic Area, such as Norway, where I work, and further afield. In particular, the nature of the UK's relationship with the Commonwealth, including Australia and my home country, Canada, has become a contested field of opinion, and much of it is ill-informed. Our international relations are going through disruption and flux. The changes will have profound implications for the arts, and indeed for all manner of scholarly intellectual work and contribution, and especially perhaps creative collaboration, which is so important to all of us. The free flow of ideas around the nations of the European higher education area is already being challenged by the doubts raised by Brexit, doubts about Britain's eligibility to participate in joint European projects, but also doubts about the status of continental Europeans working in the UK. Perhaps for those of us beyond those boundaries, all of this might create an opportunity. Nevertheless, for those of us who carry out research with an international emphasis, which is already abundantly clear here, it should surely be a fundamental aim for all of us, there are bound to be profound ramifications arising from these doubts. If the structures of research become more fragmented, insular, and merely protective of their own interests, what will happen to the research thinking that emerges from these structures? Whatever the effects of Brexit might turn out to be for the 6 months or so between the referendum and the bombshell of the 9th November 2016, the US presidential election, I think it was still possible to imagine it as some kind of British aberration. I do not think the world as a whole, let alone the international communities of research, was ready for the resounding rebuttal of openness, internationalization, and tolerance that the American electorate delivered. The upheaval surrounding the election process and result in the United States, and the often shocking political upheavals, challenge us in more than our political convictions. They force us to look at what we mean by humanity when aspects of the public discourse seem so inhumane, and try to do something about protecting it. The idea of holding multiple points of view, of being convinced that divergent beliefs can be honored, even if they're not agreed, and that these aspects of the human condition might be both reflected and facilitated by artwork that is complex, not black and white in its nature, its conception or reception. All this is challenged by the disintegration of honest discussion and debate that should characterize a democratic process, a disintegration that undermines our very sense of truth and how we define it. There's been resistance, of course. The corruption of power is placed into sharp relief by the emergence of, for example, the Me Too movement, which is developed first as an articulating platform for survivors of sexual harassment and abuse, and more recently as a significant site for a new kind of resistance to all kinds of discrimination. It's significant that music conservatories and music departments have in some instances, in many instances, become focal points for these discussions. This is not merely about righting the wrongs of past injustices. It concerns the very nature of institutionalized knowledge and activity, which is why the close temporal proximity of the discourses on artistic research in music and the Me Too debates has high educational, social, and ethical significance. But these debates, they require vocabularies. We've already been talking about language and our need for our own language. The horrific debasement of language that has marred the US presidential election and continues to mar discourse is an urgent wake-up call to us all. I think it's an emergency. It challenges us to protect and create anew our open, courageous, and necessarily sophisticated discourses in and through art, in resistance to trends of oversimplification and the telling of untruths. This is part of the demanding work of research, but it's also the seat of its most significant rewards. So, amidst the current maelstrom of world events, I'm now going to endeavor to turn my focus once more to our professional world, the world of research in and through the arts. Acknowledgement of the complexity of the arts and of the research that's embedded in the arts leads us back to the model of the fold that I introduced at the outset. Inspired by the work of Julian Rose and experiencing genuine concern about the pressure on the arts to instrumentalize their arguments in order to justify the financial support they need in order to survive, I've been revisiting the metaphor of unfolding as a way of understanding the processes that can go on in artistic creation, interpretation, and presentation. Explaining complexity without feeling the need to explain it away seems to me not such a bad way to demonstrate why the world needs the arts and the particular truths that the arts unfold. Using the word unfolding in this context implies a different relationship between the states of non-understanding and understanding than that suggested by the more traditional research concept of discovery or invention and so on. It carries the notion of a knowledge that is always close to us, within reach, but already an intimate part of our everyday experience, yet somehow enigmatic and wrapped up in itself until skillfully opened up to our direct gaze. By contrast, the traditional metaphors of research conjure up images of bold and pioneering expeditions into uncharted territory, which maybe doesn't belong to us, from whose alien wastes nuggets of valuable knowledge can be retrieved and brought back for the benefit of civilization. Of course, this itself is partly a matter of vocabulary and of how the connotations of words have evolved and often diverged. One of the three common and related definitions of unfolding is to remove the covers from. So literally, to discover. Perhaps it's worth looking at all three definitions and reflect briefly on their shared and distinct properties. So the first one, unfolding as to open or spread out, with this also carrying the implication of expansion in the sense that the folded object is highly compact and when unfolded occupies a greater space than before. So, expansion of knowledge as distinct from pushing forward its frontiers, that might be a useful idea for artistic research. The next one, the second, already referred to, is to remove the covers and expose to view. Although this is etymologically the closest to discovery, it's interesting to note that it still implies bringing out into the open sight of something, albeit present, except veiled. So, we may think of the cliche of something being hidden in plain sight, in which context, an agency that brings it out of concealment, may certainly be seen as contributing to knowledge and understanding. So it matters what context you do your Kano Duo work in. It's part of the unfolding of the process. The final definition is in some ways the most interesting. It is to reveal gradually by written or spoken explanation to make known. It reminds us that we often speak of a narrative as something that unfolds, as though it exists in its entirety ahead of time, but tightly coiled up and requiring a certain pace, duration, and arguably sequence, you have to do things in the right order, for its full revelation and definitive realization. This is the definition which most clearly identifies unfolding as a process, and I think in artistic research process orientation is extremely important. It's an ongoing exposition and one whose articulation is as significant as its end result of creating something that has been open, spread out, and exposed to view. Thinking of this last definition, it's interesting to contrast it with another cliche of scientific research, the eureka moment, the flash of inspiration in which revelation appears to come quasi-instantaneously and in convulsive inversion that changes the state of non-comprehension into that of comprehension. For all that, it is indeed a cliche, and by no means the invariable paradigm for either the manner or the rhythm of scientific discovery, it is revealing in the way that it once again implies the sudden and almost inexplicable arrival in our conscious experience of something previously absent, and to all intents and purposes, therefore, non-existent. The importance of the criterion of originality in the evaluation of research owes much to the idea that the researcher's contribution to knowledge is something which they, and they alone, were able to reach out and seize at a given moment in the linear evolution of knowledge. It is from this paradigm of originality that we also derive the heroic notion of research as a kind of colonization of new territories of knowledge, and the total colonization of the area being one that grows incrementally with each original contribution that is added to it. But I think for us there's a big problem with that. It's a metaphor that disadvantages arguments wishing to portray artistic creation as a species of research. That's important, I want you to think about it for a minute. We're not trying to work in that way, we have to do this some other way. Art is, in part, about making us see more clearly things that lie around us all the time, but which we all too often fail to attend to as we should. It's a call to attention that reminds us to work actively and with all our senses to apprehend life in all its richness and detail. Rather than relating to knowledge as it has generally been perceived in post-Enlightenment Western thought, as a relentlessly advancing vector, which posits always this idea of improvement, if anything, it bears greater resemblances to Eastern traditions of knowledge as the expansion of wisdom through a practice, often a contemplative practice. This is a concept that chimes well with ideas of uncovering, expansion, and a gradual narrative-oriented exegesis, and with artistic researchers making its contributions to knowledge and understanding in these terms. I'd like to show a few ways in which we might contextualize these ideas. First, I shall talk about artistic research's questioning of an enduring and thorny problem in music, the nature of Werktreue, in light of the metaphor of the fold. I shall define Werktreue oversimplistically here as the imperative that faces those of us who work with Western art music and musical reproduction, that we should aim to make our performances as faithful to the musical score and therefore to the composer as possible. Very canned definition. Yet, let's think about that. In a world in which the truth is ever more elusive as an idea, mere obedience to a score is not really sufficient, even though inside the walls of music conservatoires, the practices around Werktreue still hold sway, including my own. We have advanced artistic research, but most of the music studios purport to maintain the standard vectorial model. But this idea, this problem, is actually an opportunity. It's the site of a fold. It's a schism between the external sense of the demands of the score and the internal imperatives of the musical artist. So suddenly it gets interesting. I'm going to play this. I would have played it, but the piano's invisible, so. I am passing the task on to a dude named Glenn Gould. Probably many of you know this piece. It's the last of Arnold Schoenberg's Six Little Pieces, Opus 19, and it has a well-known association with the death of Gustav Mahler, as can be seen in a famous contemporaneous painting by Schoenberg, which he called The Burial of Gustav Mahler, painted in May 1911. It's all too easy to relate mournful, nostalgic quality of the music to that single aspect of its genesis. However, the musical material itself tells a broader story of looking regretfully back into the past through the unfolding of references to the previous movements of the entire work, in particular the opening of the first piece. So for example, the tones of the bell, that opening wide chord, relates to the opening of the whole work. If we unfold things further, this complicated state of nostalgia, which is very intensively troped in this piece, may extend beyond the core of the material and become a topic for wider reflection within performance on the nature of sounds and silences in any performance. So I think that this piece is leaky. What do I mean? Over years of working on this little piece, I became particularly interested in Schoenberg's sketches, which are found in the archives of the Arnold Schoenberg Center in Vienna and are now published in a facsimile edition. I became fascinated by the way that Schoenberg pulls the work through his process of sketching into ever-decreasing dynamic realms. And what I mean by that is that he performed himself the process of getting ever softer and more silent in that little piece while he composed it, as if he were the performing artist and not merely the composer. So let's look at this fair copy and I'll try to explain what I mean. In rough sketches before this one, the fourth bar is actually this whole complex here. It's of interest because of the presence in ink of a pianissimo marking. It starts with two pianos, to which is added in gray pencil in that earlier version, another set of pianissimo markings in the same bar. But in this advanced copy, these two pianos are replaced by three. And in fact, can you see in red pencil, he added another one, four pianos. So that the hapless pianist is faced with this problem of how to play at a dynamic level of four pianos. If you play the piano, then you'll know that's hard to do. However, Schoenberg differentiates this from a piano single P dynamic on the D sharp. So you have to play four pianos there and then the D sharp up there only on one piano. So you're becoming a curator of pianissimi across the range in a single bar of music. So, In this context, that single piano feels almost like a forte, while for the other notes, the pianist has to flirt with the danger of the key being touched so lightly that there's going to be no sound emerging at all. And that's important. That aspect of the risk of it not working is part of what matters in the piece more than playing the notation as it is. So the work's sketched outline into near silence has been essential for my understanding of the nature of the work, but also the whole nature of Schoenberg's critical compositional project. So this is an unfolded paradigm of a lifetime's musical compositional practice. It means for me that the main focus of my work on the piece concerns sound itself, tone and sonority, but also the journey towards how sound is extinguished. Sounds that hover on this boundary of silence and that force the pianist to risk the danger of that boundary being crossed become in some sense a sonorous metaphor for that silence. There's a fold or a hinge in this indeterminate and fragile zone between what sounds and what does not. This piece is essentially an exploration of the binary ambivalence of this zone. We love it, but we fear it. And as we've seen, Schoenberg's sketches show his exploration as he edged ever closer to the center of the fold itself, where silence becomes not silence. And this trope of silence in Schoenberg's music is not merely a fact of the score to be observed. It concerns the historicity of music, the truth content discussed previously, and it is in searching for the appropriate sonority through listening as a form of contemplation that I believe we come nearest to reaching that content, although as ever, it's elusive too. We can't get to the center. In other words, though, we can't consider aspects of notation at all. We just can't consider them in a hermetically sealed way. And that's what I meant when I said I think this piece is really leaky. An important dimension in developing a performance, and indeed in understanding other arts, is to learn something, of course, of the personal context of the artist, his or her personal expertise, previous experiences, education, embeddedness in a culture, a community of musicians, the cultural stock, as well as the influence of his or her character and temperament. Some of these parameters may be well known or at least easily accessed. Others are already present, but in an imminent, unconscious way. So when I talk about all that stuff, it doesn't mean that you need to know the facts of that stuff, but the stuff is a matter of fact. For the purposes of research, the last statement is, of course, that's problematic. Research generally exacts verification, veracity. Artistic creation finds its veracity in that which is created. This is the problem that Leon was talking about this morning. We see that efforts to understand the cultural semiotic codes of the music, also known as the score, can run straight into personal as opposed to explicit or propositional knowledge. In this case, a strongly internalized sense of the music's historicity. For me, trained as a performer, but also trained to PhD level as a musicologist, it is natural that this would be so. But the world is not my idea. It's not yours either. The world is not our idea. So it might not be the response of another performer, nor would sketch study necessarily be a port of call for every musician. It is important in this kind of inquiry to remember that although it is indeed the artist that makes the difference to the research process, this same artist cannot be where the objectivity of the work's realization lies, if indeed it can lie anywhere. The conundrum of Eric Troy with reference to Western art music and the rise of artistic research can be conceived in terms of two opposed or folded over notions, with the former, Werktreue, being associated with the faithful rendition of the musical text and the performer acting in the service of this, and the latter, artistic research, becoming increasingly concerned with breaching the stronghold of the text so that performers may remake its materials in new ways rather than reproducing the score in accordance with a set of rules. There is an increasingly strong move towards this where I currently work in Norway. seeing the unfolding of musical performance as the imparting of knowledge at a specific time and place, and through the rhythms and conventions of narrative, encourages us to think beyond the simple equation that the more faithfully a performance matches the set of instructions that's embodied in the score, the better it is. It means that there are times when we might rate a performance more highly precisely insofar as it pushes creatively at the boundaries of identity that are defined by the musical text. The artistic research movement, more generally, has an emergent question circulating within it to do whether the rupture of truth content that characterizes so many artistic research projects is a near inevitable corollary of the post-truth world. If we can no longer believe in truth content embedded within musical texts that adorn our formulation, if we consider composers' intentions to be impossible to retrieve from the ciphers of the score, then our rigid adherence to its many markings and codes may belong somewhere else. Indeed, the scholar Daniel Leach Wilkinson has gone further in a recent address called Preening Mannerists and the Performance Police by proposing an argument that Werktreue could be considered unethical. Werktreue is considered unethical. Why? Because it places a human being's enmeshed within its various kinds of structures into dangerous physical and psychological servitude and hazard. He cites the high number of performance injuries within conservatoires as part of his evidence. In response to an idea like that, which is extreme, many artists researchers are going a different way by using musical texts more as repositories of source material through which they search for new ways of working, pushing hard at the boundary of what a work actually is, if we can ever figure that out, to the extent that the predictable form can disappear with something unexpected taking its place. Of course, it is still presumed that the work in its most essential nature survives this rough treatment. But is that necessarily true? And even if one accepts that oral and performative milieu is part of what constitutes a work, are these kinds of machinations necessarily for the better? For artistic researchers who need to develop a critical sense of all this. Some scholars of the more scientific disciplines within music scholarship, they're pushing back, suggesting that the unbridled messing about with scores is not all it's purported to be. Some argue that it's merely a symptom of the exaggerated subjectivity and reflexivity of our post-millennial world, in which all is autobiography reduced to a set of selfies with blog captions underneath. So, if recalling the scientist's scornful comment in the film Contagion, blogging is not writing, it's graffiti with punctuation, then what is happening to the power of the critical voice, our critical voices, in the echo chamber of cyberspace? We're already starting to unpick these problems. Does this not make us vulnerable to precisely the doublespeak with which we are inundated in the wider media space? If the everything goes, is the everything goes model an approach full of expressive potentiality, or is it a recipe actually for flattening that expression? Might it not from time to time lead us to devastatingly bad choices, artistic, ethical, and both? Perhaps more productively, we might look at these divergent approaches as two sides of the same argument but folded over one another. After all, the empathic communication of information and experiences, and not merely the verbally empathic, that's a sign of research transferability. It's a marker for research content. Nevertheless, in some circles, that's still a heretical point of view. Research, in its more traditional manifestations, mistrusts empathy and the individually incarnated human experience. The researcher, although a sentient being in the world, is expected to behave dispassionately in relation to their own research. There's a distrust for insights that come from quasi-spontaneous, instinctive experience. So, for the construction of empathic yet proper systems in which we can do our work, the structures have to change. perhaps it is within art itself that we see instances of folding that can be read as a meta-language, i.e. that the idea of the fold can allow music to talk to sculpture, to talk to writing, and so on. So now I'm going to experiment with some other genres of art making. So I'm going to tell you a story. It's called The Cost of Perfection by Mr. W. Mr. W. must be a real guy, but I don't know who he is, but there's a website with the shortest stories in the universe in which Mr. W. has this story. So we read, after a lifetime in the craft, he was startled to find in his rough hands the perfect dust brush. When he had made it, there had been no flaw in the polished mahogany handle, of course, but the wood grain swooped and curled more elegantly than he had realized. The fine horsehair had only subtle but necessary variations in its hue, and the brush flared from its compact base to a beautiful sweep. It was impossible that this dust brush could scratch a surface, no matter how delicate. He knew then it was time to retire from the craft. He built a grand illuminated case with a glass front to display the dust brush. Several weeks later, he noticed with professional eye a thin film of dust on the glass. To use the dust brush itself would be sacrilege, but to use another brush in its presence would be an insult. At a loss, he shifted his weight one foot to the other and blinked back tears. The end. The fold here is in that sentence. He knew then it was time to retire from the craft. It creates a hinge whereby the subject of the story moves from being immersed in the virtuosic, aesthetically highly realized practice, the sensuous experience of sweeping with the perfect dust brush, to becoming a curator and experiencing the loss of his practice in a manner so poignant that he is brought to tears, with the perfect dust brush becoming a mere object of contemplation. Debating about this, we might consider it a critique of curation that echoes many such discourses that are taking place in the arts. It also brings forward the question of ethics in the arts. An ethical moment is a moment of choice. Here, the choice to retire, seemingly an ethical one emerging from an insoluble aporia, the high point of aesthetic appreciation of the dust brush, being perceived as a sign to remove it and its user from action, it simply leads to another aporia. The brush's dual identity as an art object and a functional tool turns into an irreconcilable paradox that paralyzes the artist's capacity for action. Of course, sincere responses to ethical imperatives do not necessarily lead to happiness. This example also requires us to consider the nature of storytelling. Narrators require both a storyteller and an audience. They're not just about the contents to be delivered, but also the event of delivery, the transactional process through which content is transmitted. This process may be predominantly unidirectional, but no decent storyteller unfolds the narrative in the same way to each audience. Subliminal feedback derives from small reactions, expressions, postures, murmurs, audible shuffling. This will all influence the quality of the unfolding, and in the process, reshape the storyteller's own relationship with the context of the story. As a result, both storyteller and audience are changed by the narrative that is unfolded. Knowledge is created within the event itself, not merely transmitted one more time in the self-same way that has occurred in the past and will again in the future. Each unfolding, while preserving the essential characteristics of the narrative archetype, is also unique and irreproducible. And this offers a more general lesson about the limitations of trying to understand artistic research in terms of the criteria of its dominant scientific counterpart. we have to be clear. Hearing a piece of music or listening to reading of fiction, it doesn't communicate a literal truth, but a compelling realization generates its own sense of psychological verisimilitude, its own immersive world. Our sense of immersion in the best of such realizations is a function of the vitality of this kind of world creation. But it's a complex thing. It's full of wonder, but also full of folds, faults, striations, mistakes, screw-ups. I believe that this place of the fold is a place of risk in its acknowledgement of the impossibility of perfection. Gillian Rose's term for it in her theoretical system is the broken middle. But lately I've been calling it the touching middle because of the way that flat planes make contact when they are folded one over the other. It's a place of our work. It's a place of questions. It's also a place of differences and disagreements. That's all fine. It's a locus for recognizing the impossibility of reconciling different positions, but allowing these positions to exist, mediating between the ethical, the collective tradition, and culture of a particular community, and self-expressive nonconformity. We can have room for it all. To underline this, I'd like to present a model that I've been working on for years, and first presented when I gave an inaugural lecture at the Arne Nordheim Center for Artistic Research, which I founded in 2015. According to this model, we need to navigate back and forth in our process of unfolding. We need to move to and fro from personal, my project, the creation of your own world and the self-orientation, this absorption that art requires, it's necessary. But in artistic research, something else is required. The transpersonal addressing of meta-questions in the world, and with the intelligent, even empathic understanding of other points of view, which doesn't mean that you have to agree with those points of view. We could think of these extremes of orientation as coming to a near but never total resolution in the middle of that figure where the fold is shown. We might think of the act of moving back and forth from the personal to the transpersonal realms as negotiating this tight place of the fold with its fractures, its points of damage, its weaknesses, but also its potential for reshaping, making three-dimensional, making less rigid and reforming, in other words, art making. The fold, that blue dotted line in the middle, that's our place of transition and negotiation. It's full of possibilities. It's a site of epistemic possibility, a site for the emergence of new knowledge. But it's also the weakest place. It's fragile. It's the place that tears under pressure. And we know that creativity is challenged by intolerance, impressions, and ripping apart. So that place of the fold, when we encounter it in ourselves or in our researchers, needs compassionate treatment. I spoke before of the touching middle, and perhaps we could say that when folded over these two planes, they touch each other. Perhaps it is in those points of contact or touching that the most profound insights take place. In this kind of modeling, perhaps the most innovative of artistic research must somehow stand with Werktreue, with tradition and the past, in order for the full nature of both to be exposed. With willful non-comprehension, it's not working well for our global politics at the moment. For our research, it's untenable. We need to keep looking. With this in mind, offer one more example, or a couple more actually, as a way to think about folding. So I made this from a flat square of paper. Just a piece of paper like this piece of my speech. It's actually the Brisbane city map. My processes of folding made the raw material into an object that's no longer a flat piece of paper. But I need to breathe into it. I need to give it life in order for its context to be fully expressed. So this is a Japanese water bomb. It's a simple form of origami, the art of paper folding. You really can fill this with water and throw it at your enemy. When I was a kid, I often did that. The irony of implied aggression suits our global political model all too well, as if the historicity of the making is imprinted on the materiality of the object. But if I unfold this paper, I get the images of a series of pieces of work, the traces of the art making, the ghosts of the research process. I could use these full traces to remake the square into something quite different than a three-dimensional cube. The same base fold makes this origami fortune teller, which begins with exactly the same process. But at a crucial point, you're going to tell your fortune. So, blue, red, yellow, or green?
Green.
One, two, five, or six?
Five.
You will figure out an old puzzle. Okay. At a crucial point, when I was making these two things, I had to make two different choices. They shared a common root, but at a certain point, I had to do something else. In other words, what the sketch leaves for me is multiplicity, options. That's, again, one of the great things about our work. But if I wish to remake a cube, I have to fold the paper in a certain way. Art making is very specific, for all that it contains multitudes. Multidimensionality is an aspect of responsible art making, responsible articulation of what it may mean and what is at stake. That's the province of artistic research. In the case of our Vectroid critique, we may see the folding together of art making and articulating the meaning of art as making a more flexible creative space, one that may be verbally mediated or one where the art simply speaks for itself. Working to spread this understanding beyond our small community of the art form in question itself introduces the idea of social responsibility, the notion that art still matters. Given all this, artistic research could fold further over itself into becoming a more complex, multidimensional, and consequential community so that its discourses become the province of more than just a few. As scholars in art disciplines, we are used to the distinction between instinct and analysis, between what we take in at a single glance and what we come to understand by taking things apart. Part of this distinction is colored by the dichotomy between subjectivity and objectivity. The discipline of analysis not only makes us pause, arresting our impulse to leap into personally driven conclusions, but also breaks down our reactions and responses into component pieces of evidence, which in theory hold good, irrespective of the individual who may be observing them. Analysis is a potent tool for our deepening of understanding, especially in the scientific disciplines to which we relate. But it is predicated on the concept that breaking down a complex entity is a reversible process, that if we understand the parts in isolation, we also understand how they will function when recombined. That's dangerous. Even in the scientific field, there are areas where the limitations of this approach are recognized. In the arts, such limitations are even more pronounced. Art, especially of any sophistication, functions organically with all its elements in dynamic interaction. Take them apart, and we may gain certain types of understanding about technique, structure, and so on, but we often learn notoriously little about the very things that make art matter to us in the first place. This is where unfolding may serve as a better approach suited to deepening our understanding of art, and one in which our individual and collective relationships to that art, instead of being put to one side in the name of objectivity, may be retained as integral to our understanding. Unfolding implies bringing to the visible exterior things that are normally hidden on the inside. But this does not require their separation from one another to achieve this. On the contrary, the unfolded entity is still single and connected. Indeed, it is the folds, the lines of intersection, that are more important in this process than the areas which they connect. Instead of dissembling, and if you remember that dissemble in Latin, or it comes from the Greek to loosen up, it is about explaining from the Latin explicare, to fold out. Perhaps we can work creatively with this seam, allowing ourselves to be unsettled by the way that both as self-expressive nonconformists and people with collective traditions, you have a collective tradition here and it's strong. We're forced to challenge our ideas and assumptions in the process of becoming creative individuals. But for this, we need strong communities as a reference. And in this respect, in Norway, I'm fortunate to work in a community with a national artistic research program funded by the government. Here in Australia, your institutions are sitting here working together to try to figure out some of these questions. Functioning as a true artistic research community with consistent processes through which we exchange ideas, experiences, new creations, new knowledge, using these processes as a way to develop ours as researchers and engage ourselves with different worldviews is vital. And I know you're doing a lot of work on this. To artistically challenge everything, everything, whilst also remaining committed to our community and the community of artistic researchers around the world, that seems to be something worth doing. Why? Because the unfolding of events before then, but especially since 2016, it's shown us a real danger of the misuse of certain kinds of power. As a believer in the multiplicity of options, I hope we can unfold a different story than that. Because the liveliness of working with art and through art is sorely needed in a world where deliberate speaking of untruths with the intention of deceiving is gripping our politics. If engaging with art can help us to become better unfolders, using our feelings and our intellect in combination as we strive for better understanding, it can also be an increasingly valuable tool for grappling with the complex and interconnected phenomena that we encounter in our modern globalized societies. It can also help us to explain these phenomena to people who feel left out, outcast from life progress, so that they might resume true enlightened participation. But we have a lot of work to do, because interconnectedness is both the greatest challenge and the greatest potential opportunity of our modern society. We all have to learn how to be better unfolders, how to explain our world to ourselves and each other in ways that transcend segregation, whether intellectual or social. If art can teach us useful lessons in unfolding, it can also offer us valuable insights into how life is governed more by process than outcome. We may yearn for destinations, whether in our individual lives or collectively, but the reality of our existence is one of flux. Art provides us with metaphors for this and helps us to gain satisfaction and enrichment from dynamism as opposed to stasis. As such, it is again an indispensable tool for understanding the world that we live in here and now, and collectively how we can get most out of it. Perhaps the key word here is collectively. The fold and the touching middle, which it creates, doubles the strength of the two the surfaces that are in contact with one another. We should not overestimate the power of our discipline to change the world for the better, but nor should we undersell its value as a corrective to the narrowing of vision and imagination, which can sometimes feel to us like it's dominating everything. We must not despair. We have the means to make a difference, however small. So let's take our courage in our hands. Let's work together in this fascinating field to honor existing art making, to support new work, and to get to the very core, the touching middle that this knowledge can give us in support of a better world. Thank you.